I'm very happy to welcome all of you here at Kyiv School of Economics. I really ask those who are in the last line, come to the front and join us here. We have some free tables, like free chairs here. I'm sorry, because I was running, because we host also Minister of Finance downstairs, Natalie Resko, and we are very busy with a lot of events, but we are very honored to host today our honored guest, Alojz Peterle from Slovenia, who has fantastic experience being Prime Minister of Slovenia, and make the country as a sovereign and as went through the process of national identity building. You'll probably tell much more about that. Sorry for my very brief introduction. And I do, from Kyiv School of Economics, welcome all of you. And we are very happy that together with Wilfred Martin Center and our partners, reanimation package of reforms and Stronger Together campaign, we could have this program, which is called Ukraine Reforms. And we invite brilliant people from our neighboring countries, great reformers who already have done a lot of a great job in their own countries. We invite them to share experience and share ideas here in Ukraine, because probably everyone knows that we are trying to go through this reform processes, and it's very not easy, very slowly. So with the help of our friends, our neighbors, we hope and we try to push it more more and more, and we expecting better results in nearest future. So, Mr. Peterle, the floor is yours. Enjoy an hour and a half. The stage is open for questions, so you feel free after a short lecture, ask your questions, and I hope we'll have productive interactive discussion today. Thank you for coming again, and the floor is yours.
Спасибо большое. Добрий вечір. Ми по-словенську речемо «добрий вечір», бо то не велика різниця. Мислим, да би се добре розуміли, чи би говорив само по-словенську. А не тако. So, thank you very much for inviting me. I would say it's quite a privilege and honor for me to have the chance to share with you, I would say, future of your country. Because you will take responsibility, or you are taking responsibility already for your country, and it's special opportunity for me to share some of my experiences and maybe some comments on what we did. I will not be very romantic, despite the fact that some elements in Slovenian story are quite romantic, but it was a hard time. I would like to tell you that I spent my first 42 years in the communist Yugoslavia as, I would say, politically nobody, because the politics was reserved for the communists. I was part of a so-called civil society, which was quite weak. I worked for a magazine which was called 2000. It was established in 68, in the famous 68, with student movement in France and with occupation of Czech Republic at that time. In that magazine, we were studying philosophy, also economics and so on. So I would say that I was, in a way, prepared for the function I got later. I studied some history, geography, and economics. And I think that history and geography and economics is a very good mixture for those who wish to become politicians, because you need to know something about the time, something about the space, let's say so, and something about money. I have to say that it was never my dream that I should become prime minister. I was not obsessed by that. And I think I still don't depend, I'm not obsessed by the positions. The highest positions I got in my political career were in fact were not the expression of my political will. But by surprise, my party won. I established Christian Democratic Party with my friends, and nobody predicted our victory. So then I even offered that post to a friend of mine who used to live in Germany, and I thought he knew more about democracy, but he refused, so then I had to jump in that water, and I don't regret that. At that time, we won as Christian Democrats within a coalition which was called Demos. It was composed of 6 parties. It's quite a number, I would say. It was not always easy. We were together Christian Democrats, Social Democrats, Greens. The Green Party was the first European Green Party which was part of the government, and we have also Liberals. So we have quite a rainbow. And our main tasks or my main points on our program were democratization and independence. I would like to share with you some historic facts. I have to be a historian a little bit as well. In 7th and 8th century, we have a kind of statehood in that terms, but we are fighting with Bavarians, with Avars, and then we lost our independence. Then so-called Dukes of Celje appeared, who were competitors of Habsburgs and Hyundais in Hungary, later Hungary. And then the last man of that family, Duke Ulrich, was killed in Belgrade in 1456. And since then, because there was a contract between two families, so we spent next 500 years under Habsburgs. And I will jump to the First World War. We paid a big price because the main and the last battles of First World War took place on the Slovenian territory, which is now partly in Italy. And many of our relatives were killed there. And in 1917, all the members of the Austro-Hungarian parliament, who were, the so-called Slavic members from south, it was so-called Jugoslovanski klub, led by a certain man with the name Kurošec, a Slovenian one, they proposed with so-called May Declaration, restructuring of the monarchy into a different, structure. And their suggestion was that all the South Slavs or Yugoslavs should live in one political unit. The other one would be German one, the third one Hungarian, and so on. But of course, as usually, empires don't like to hear such ideas, and Habsburg monarchy disappeared at that time. And then in October 1918, first state of Slovenians, Croats and Serbs was established. 1 month later, this transferred into kingdom of Serbs, Croats and Slovenians because the Serbian kingdom joined that new state. And in 1929, this became Kingdom of Yugoslavia, which was considered more or less as a Serbian dictatorship. And then in World War II, we were blessed by special events, but our communists, which were educated in Moscow, decided to do, during the war, authentic communist revolution. That revolution was not imported, that it was imported or exported to Hungary, to Poland, or to Czech Republic. It was done by our communists. And since then, we still have problems, I would say, because the communists decided to use the situation to take over. They did so during the war. You know that Tito Yugoslavia was established in 1943. And in Slovenia, this is the tragic element in our history, more people were killed by communists than by three occupiers. And more people were killed after the war than during the war. And we are still facing problems because of that fact. We discovered more than 600 massive graves so far, but the process has not been finished yet. I just would like to tell you that in such a small country, which became one of the main cemeteries after Second World War, such events can occur, and we still have problems with the so-called national reconciliation. No? This is special story. But let's leave this tragic part of our recent history. Now I will say a few words about the so-called Slovenian Spring. The idea of the Slovenian statehood or sovereign state was alive, I would say, for centuries. After Second World War, it was stronger in the diaspora, in United States, in Australia, in Latin America. But also in Slovenia, we were not able to express that in public, but these ideas were always alive. And we said we just wish the same possibilities as the others have or had at that time. And in 1987, the so-called 57th number of or issue of Nova Revija appeared with Slovenian national program. So we didn't have kings after 8th century, we didn't have generals, prime ministers, but we always had good writers, good priests who were taking care for our national identity, for our language, and so on. And again, the writers were there who prepared a new May declaration, which was the main, I would say, foundation for the new established Slovenian democratic parties. And my party was established in March 1989, so also the Green Party, Liberals, Social Democrats, and so on. And then in April 1990, we won as a coalition this first democratic elections in Slovenia, with two main points, as I said, democracy and independence. And this was a decisive moment I would like to share a little bit deeper with you. The expectation of the communists who lost elections was, and they even announced that in foreign press, that the new leadership will do something similar what they did after the Second World War. They killed, as I said, many people. And there were people who were on the way from Slovenia because they expected revenge. At that time, I said, as a prime minister, that one revolution was enough and too much. It was too expensive for us. And we said, we will not do revenge. Our revenge will be new rules, rule of law, social market economy, sense for human dignity, and so on. We spoke about lustration at that time, but there was no unity, there was no majority for that. And if, in case we would agree to do the so-called lustration, I think that we would have problems with our independence. Our idea was, let's be as united as possible. We were very inclusive. We invited the defeated communists, or there were parties of communist origin. We invited them to prepare a referendum. This was quite a hard negotiation. We had, there was a lack of confidence at the beginning, but in the end, what was very important, we agreed how to do that referendum or plebiscite on the 23rd of December in 1990. And people were pleased by our, I would say, joint approach. And almost 90% of Slovenians voted in favor of Slovenian independence. And from the 26th of December, it was known that the law was adopted that the state has to be proclaimed latest 6 months after the referendum. And so happened. So this is one part of the story. Now I would like to mention another element. You know, it's very interesting moment when you win elections. Now, some of you are in the political parties, you participated in the change, or you are participating in the change which is going on. And the question was, despite the fact that we had program, of course, we had strategy and so on, but we had some debates how to do or what to do. And some had ideas, you know, let's do economy like Germans, let's develop cultural policy like French, like France, let's have health as like in Netherlands, or let's have urbanism like in Sweden, no? But it's not possible to combine, I would say, those cherries from everywhere. You need to choose a system. You should work at all fronts at the same time. It is not possible to do today economy and tomorrow social policy and then culture and so on. No? This was so, and we did our democratic reforms in those days. And I would like to tell you that after that plebiscite for independence, we, together with Croats, this is maybe not known to you, we suggested a peaceful restructuring of Yugoslavia into a loose confederation, no? With common army, money, foreign policy, and so on. No? But Milosevic, if this name is still known to you, Milosevic refused that. No? So, June 25th, we proclaimed our independence. A few hours later, we were attacked by Yugoslav Communist Army. Despite the fact that in the then Yugoslav constitution, there was the right for self-determination, but also secession. So it was there, but it was like an ornament. It was not meant seriously. So we tried to negotiate our independence, but it was not possible. I visited Belgrade, the Prime Minister Marković, many times. Also the president of the collective presidency, Jović. And I remember then I heard rumors after that he commented my visit there that one more Slovenian declaration. But when we were attacked by Yugoslav Communist Army, so we were ready. And the war in Slovenia lasted only 10 days. I spent all those 10 days in my governmental office. I'm pleased that we were ready enough in order to defend ourselves. I remember how it was when Margaret Thatcher called me at that time. These were, I would say, special days. But before this happened, I would like to say that all diplomats, professionals, so-called Western realists and so on, they all told us, you will not succeed, you will not get any support. When Marković came to Slovenia, said, you will not get one single dollar, and so on. Those political high-ranking visitors, they told us, politics is the art of the possible. I'm pleased that we turned it in the art of the impossible. We made our state, independent states, we won war, we introduced our currency, and so on. And now I would like to tell you that before the I would say, high titles recognized Slovenia, it was Ukraine, which was one of the first, to recognize Slovenia. It was also the first Slavic country which recognized Slovenia, and we are still thankful for that. And then on the 13th of January, the Holy See recognized Slovenia. This was very important, I would say, moral political push. And on the 15th of January, European Community, it was called Community at times, recognized Slovenia. So, and then we joined the United Nations, Council of Europe, OSCE, EU and NATO in 2004. Now I would like to mention what happened afterwards. You know, people would expect now they achieved all, I would say, great objectives. Now the government will continue. It was not so. When we finished, let's say so, external front with international recognition, then the left part of my government became nervous, and I would say then I survived two non-confident votes, but not the third one, and the left part of my coalition decided to go with the former communists against the Christian Democrats, you know, and we were the only party which was not in the next government for lasted just for 7 months. You know? So the main question at that time, this will sound very, I mean, it will not be strange to your for your ears. The main question at that time was who will lead the privatization and how, no? So the finish of that Demos government was a frustrating fact for many of our voters because they expected we will continue after these great initial reforms. They expected that then we will do much more, no? But this was not the fact. But I would like to say that despite the fact that the dynamics of the reforms was slowed down, the so-called mixed governments, parties of communist origin with so-called pink parties, then assured the European path for Slovenia. And here I would like to make an accent. I think it was very important for us that EU or our way to the European Union did never cause a division, political division in Slovenia. We had so-called political coordination among the presidents of the parliamentary parties. We had regular meetings, and we were able to deal with all also unpleasant issues related to the accession process. And wherever I speak, wherever I see European ambition, then I mention this because I think it's very important for Serbia, for Macedonia, for Albania and so on, that Europe does not divide but unite political forces. I would like also to tell you that in Slovenia, it was not just a geopolitical interest to land after half of century of divided Europe, to land at the right side, let's say so, ne? To land at the western side of Europe. We really wish to share the same values and principles and common future with other free nations and peoples in Europe. And I remember that I'm frequently asked how hard were negotiations, accession negotiations, and in fact, we did not negotiate about human rights. We wished to share the same approach, the same line as far as human rights are concerned with other European nations. Today this seems funny, but we were negotiating for the status of our bees. I'm beekeeper myself, pčelovod, and we were negotiating the status of our wine, which is called Cviček. Did somebody hear for that name, that brand? Cviček is the wine from my region. No, but it's very good for sugar disease because it has special acid. But in Europe, only those beverages are recognized as wine which get more than 10 degrees of alcohol, but that our wine usually gets a little bit less as 10. So we had to negotiate the right for Cvicek to be named wine even with less than 10%, no, the 10 degrees of alcohol. So this is a special story for my region particularly. And for the bees, you know, for many member states, it was funny fact that we negotiated that special status. There is no flying zone for other bees in Slovenia. Only Slovenian bees are allowed to fly in Slovenia. No? This means that other beekeepers may not come with their bees to Slovenia. We can go wherever we wish in Europe, but for now they understand that this is a protection measure for our special bee, which is called Apis mellifera carnica. It's very industrious bee, very, very, quite peaceful and so on. So we were able to keep this race, let's say so, our species in Slovenia by that measure. And today nobody laughs anymore about Slovenian bees. No? You see that these succession stories can be even funny, I would say, but I'm pleased that we were that determined at that time as far as bees and Cvicek are concerned. So now back to the question of growth. You know, my government inherited in that Yugoslav economic and political situation minus 8% economic growth. No? So Slovenia was going down. We were still sending goods to the south, but because of our attitude towards Albanians in Kosovo, Serbia decided not to accept our goods or not to pay them. So the goods went still there, but there was no money. No? So it was very, very hard time, and we have to reorient our selling from Yugoslav market to the Western markets and to accept their ecologic and business and ethical standards. And I still remember that the managers, the directors, were the first category which was very much interested in European developments or in our accession. They issued some very strong statements and I would say pushing politics to be fast with the European path. Despite that, those minus 8% in 1993, this means 2-3 years later, we achieved already 3% of economic growth. This is the proof that with the right political or economical measures, with if you are able to change framework conditions, economy may breathe. And many companies, bigger or smaller, which were selling 90% of their products to the south, they reoriented them, they restructured them, and they, in few years, were able to sell more to the west than before to the east or south. So for me, one of the most, I would say, one of the best memories to that time is how Slovenian economy was adaptable, how they were able to adapt to the new situation. We, of course, as a government, we offered better conditions, better possibilities. I would say, thinking about the situation in Ukraine now, I would like to tell you that the first growth which appeared was based more or less on SMEs, small and medium size enterprises, and on construction sector, because we had to build highways and so on. No? Later, the attitude towards smaller business was different. No? So, and this growth, between 3 and 5 or even more, was the fact till 2006. No? And Slovenia was considered as a success story. Then we also developed the communes, So we did many things. I will not go into details. And I remember then, I will tell you a special fact that I met as a foreign minister, Chinese foreign minister Xi Jinping, officially twice in 1 year. It never happened because China has very strict rules. And then I asked him in Beijing why they were so attentive to Slovenia, and they recognized us before Russia or United States or the so-called big powers. And he said, you are a very interesting labor for us because you did a transition in a peaceful way. He said, we are not interested in what other countries are doing that much, but you are, for us, very, very interesting case. And so it was interesting to hear they from not that so small country as China is. No? So now I will, from that success story, I will add to the success story also the fact that we were the first new member states in the European Union which took the presidency of the European Union. We were also the first to introduce euro as a currency. But there are some buts. When the global financial crisis occurred, then that crisis revealed, I would say, many European internal reasons for the crisis and revealed also Slovenian reasons. And after that demos or my government, I would say that slowly the old habits, the old behavior, and the old old concepts were back. We saw at work, I would say, old approach, a kind of restoration. And you as an economist will be surprised that Slovenia is still the country with the highest share of the state-owned property. I think over 60%. No, so I'm convinced that Slovenia or the circles, the most influential circles, formally accepted European rules as far as social market economy is concerned, but many monopolies were maintained. Those who went a little bit through statistics that we are now much higher in corruption index and other indexes which are not pleasant, I would say, for us. And we step by step, I would say, I say that we prolonged the past and we were not enough open for new things. So formally we accepted European rules. European Union said Slovenia is a functioning market economy. I think that we have weaknesses and I'm critical to that. And corruption is always, in my view, it's always consequence of non-functioning rule of law. And there is another element I would like to mention that in my country, maybe it is not the only one from former communist countries, but we saw the obsession with property or obsession with privatization. And the question who was much stronger than question what. No? And there was such a competition, of course, a lot of stealing and so on, which ended in a moral disaster. People today don't have confidence in politics, in the leaders. To be a politician in my country today is not a pleasant business, let's say so. And we are still in this situation in which we need to undertake something. We have quite high foreign debt. We have budget deficit over Copenhagen criteria. I would say that in the 90s we were able to accommodate to the new situation. We were able to use the opportunity. We knew what we had to invest in order to get benefits later. We even convinced our citizens that we must invest in order to have a sustainable situation later. But now, after four governments in last 4 years, Slovenia was not able to do substantial reforms. And those problems we are facing at home are not problems caused by European Union. Germany now is preparing for the new, for the second generation of reforms. Those who study Germany would know what did Genscher, what Angela Merkel's government did after him. But there are other countries, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Austria, which did that. But there are countries, especially in the south of Europe, which were not able to do that. No? And here, of course, we are facing problems. We cannot live together in such, I would say, huge 500 million big union with two understandings of rule of law, with two understandings of social principles of social market economy, and with different fiscal countries. I said for the television before what happened to me when I was a student, and Autostop was popular at that time. I don't know. Do you do that still? Autostop? No. In Europe, this was very popular. The students without money were just you raise a finger and you get a car and you go. No. And I got somebody from Sweden. No. And he was in such a good mood, and he said, I'm fine today, I'm proud. And I said, well, what happened to you? He said, I paid all my taxes to the state. Then I said, oh, I said, I'm coming from a country where people are proud if they don't do so. And there are still such countries or such people in the European Union, maybe not only there. I will continue in that regard. Can you imagine now Giscard d'Estaing, the former French president, suggests to begin with a new European, I would say, core region, to have just 12 countries together, from the eastern side only Poland, he counts there, and he said fiscal union, economic union, and whatever union, political union. But I would like to know who will collect taxes in one or the other country where taxes will not be collected. Will Angela Merkel send somebody to another country? Will Monsieur Hollande send somebody? No. It's now we are facing the problems with different administrative cultures, with different fiscal countries. No? There are differences which are pleasant. You dance in a different different way we dance. You cook in a different way we cook, and we like these differences. We like to enjoy your food here, and you enjoy Slovenian food in Slovenia. But there are differences which make problems. And now European Union is facing many problems. But Slovenians still mean that the decision was okay. 70% of Slovenians are still convinced that there was no better choice, and they wish to continue. And after several decades of growth in the European Union, now we are facing less romantic time, and we have to find solutions or responses. And some words about European Union and Slovenia. Now, we were criticized by former, more or less communists who were in love in Yugoslavia. By the way, Yugoslavia was not killed by the Democrats. Yugoslavia was finished because the communists were not able to agree how to continue after Tito's death. No? We knew that European Union is not a love community, is not a romantic marriage. It's a community it is community of values and principles and common rules, but it's also community of interests. But you know which rules are there, and if you join the club, you have to wear the tie, they say. No, but as I said, there was no better choice, and for us this was a success. We still get more money back than we paid there. In my campaign, 1 year ago, I visited almost all Slovenian communes. For a politician, Slovenia is quite a big country, I would say. And I saw everywhere projects financed by you. These are blue tables telling what was financed by the European Union. Our students are everywhere. You can get them at all universities in the European Union. We don't need any more to show passport. You know, when I went to Brussels in 89, I need to show my passport at three borders and to change money three times. And at each border, the value was less than before, because, you know, today, especially for you, maybe as economists, it's difficult to imagine that when we introduced our own currency, monthly inflation rate in Yugoslavia was 23%, not year, month. You know, that then you multiply and you see what was the, how high was the inflation. No, and now you can travel to the North Pole without passport. You know, you don't search anymore. You don't open the car. What you are bringing with you, and so on. And of course, I'm pleased that the new Slovenian generation does not have such an experience. They don't know what does it mean to stay at the border, because the borders disappeared. I mean, as hard borders, soft borders are still there. I mean, the borders will remain, but we can go here and there without any problems. So this is such a wonderful experience that I think all European member states have to do something, not to do just small steps, as Robert Schuman said, that European Union will do progress only by small steps. I would say that today, in facing the challenges, not only refugees and financial problems, we would need a quantum leap forward. And the problems we are facing with all of them, I will not name them, you know them, are of that nature that even the biggest country, Germany, is not able to deal with them on its own. So no country individually can do that. So we need more Europe, as we say. We need more border control. We need strong euro, and so on. I think it would be good to finish. You know, I usually speak for 2 minutes in the European Parliament, and you see how I use this time here. And we are pleased if we get 2 minutes, because there is a competition who will speak in the plenary. So let's summarize. I would say, as far as Slovenia is concerned, the first round was good. There was clear vision, clear objectives, large coalition, there was determination. We achieved main goals, but there was no sense for continuity. And we are still paying price for that. I think that vision and strategy, a good program is not enough. Even good communication is not enough. A continuity is very important. Also now in our relations between Ukraine and European Union, I don't see any sense to have 4 years pro-European government and then 4 years anti-European government and so on. I think that you overcome this, I would say, question or polarization, but still, to decide on one line does not mean yet that full success. I think that the continuity is very important, especially due to the fact that no government is able to meet expectations of the people. You know, people judge the governments, I would say, by the pockets. They like to feel the politics in the pockets. If the pocket is empty, then the government is bad. We all know that. And we know that there are situations we cannot fill pockets or fill meet expectations of the people. Now that then our second round, EU, I mean, was well, but the problem was that we did not implement the best standards as far as rule of law is concerned and social market economy. One more remark and then I will finish. I don't know how is in your country, but I'm pleased that CES, Martin's Center, friends from Christian Democracy or European People's Party are coming here with their experiences, with their knowledge, with their concepts. And I see in my country that the concept of social market economy is even not understood by those who speak about it, about them, no? And there are many people who think, or even attack us, Mr. Peterle, you are for wild capitalism, no? In favor of wild capitalism. I never spoke in favor of capitalism, no? I always spoke in favor of social market economy, which beside economic liberalism knows also common good, the concept of common good. And I think that this is the main element or main aspect of the social market economy, because it's social because we follow the principle of common good, which is very inclusive and very just, very honest, I would say. And we are attentive to the weaker in the society. These are two corrections of liberal of economic liberalism, let's say so. No? I think that this is very important when we are trying to build our societies in a sustainable way, and we can build them only if foundations are sustainable, if foundations are sound and principles are such foundations. I will not speak about solidarity. I would finish by saying that in Slovenia, but not only in Slovenia, we need political will again. We have vision, we know what to do, but there is no enough political will to do that. And I would wish that Slovenia is again in the first circle or first group. I don't like that we get marginalized. I don't like that several countries would start to build a new so-called core Europe, I mentioned before. I'm not pleased by Europe of different speeds, but I understand also those countries who say, if you are not able to follow with the right speed, we have to undertake something for ourselves because we don't like to depend on you because you are too slow for us. No? This is the problem. I think maybe you are facing similar problems. You have East and West, and you have Kiev and so on. And you have very, very difficult political context. So this is what I intended to tell you from my experiences or my political career. I'm thankful for such a long attention. I studied to be a professor, but I taught only 1 week in elementary school. So I do apologize for not being professor enough. Thank you very much for your attention.
And now I think it's the time for questions. And
good evening. My name is Natalie Kolpak, Metropolitan Communications. Well, thanks a lot for being here tonight. And I would rather start with expressing my regards for making Slovenia the way it is right now. Lovely country. I loved a lot traveling through Slovenia. I have the whole list of questions, but I'm going to try to limit myself to three. My first question will be about this Ukraine reforms and about the Martin Center. We already experienced the visit of Lech Balcerovic to here and Mikuláš Zurinda. And right now in Ukrainian parliament, we have this single tax rate as in Slovakia and some shock therapy as in Poland. So shall we expect some Slovenian panacea for Ukraine that will be governed by you? Another question of mine would be about the current state of Slovenia. To your opinion, how Slovenia should attract foreign direct investments and if something of that might be used for Ukraine? And due to my field of expertise, which is energy, I would like to know what was the energy mix of Slovenia of under your government and right now. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. You mentioned Balcerovic. I remember him at that time. And Klaus in Czech Republic and some other people. And I think that Jeffrey Sachs was advisor to many governments, also to Polish government, no? But he was also advisor to mine government, no? And I don't know whether you follow his blogs or his articles. He wrote each week a good article. And he was very educational when he spoke in Slovenian parliament. He said, if your leg is black till the knee, no? You don't heal yourself by taking a two from your head, because half of your leg is already off. No? And the more radical you are, the better for you. You know, there was we divided the enterprises into sound ones, into mixed ones, and into dead ones. To the dead, we didn't help. We helped to those who had chance to survive, and so on. I think that at that time Poland was successful with Balcerovic, Mazowiecki, and so on. Later with Buzek, especially. I won't speak about Tusk in his 8 years. Poland, for me, which was, I would say, quite behind Slovenian indicators, let's say so. Is a really truly success story. No, I don't know how much you study. I would say how much you make comparisons, but Poland was not attached by so the financial crisis didn't cause any bigger problems in Poland. No. And I spoke with my Polish friends who are former ministers and so on. And they said the main reason for that is that we had conservative banking. I like that very much. So they didn't count everybody in Poland that after 12 months there will be 25% more. No? About what all the world was counting in a way or expecting. So I think that, and then you mentioned also Dzurinda. I'm pleased that he had two mandates. In former communist countries, you need two mandates to really achieve substantial changes. If you have 2 or 3 or 4 years, in Slovenia we had only once 4 years, the so-called spring parties. All the other time, the majority was on the side of the parties of communist origin. No? By the way, in Slovak Republic, the new government was clever enough or wise enough to continue with Dzurinda's economic policy and to add something else. No, we can discuss, but Poland, as I said, is a success story. I'm also co-chairman of Working Group for Health in the European Parliament. And when you are in troubles, then to be mild is not the best solution. This is it's a simplified answer, but in the case of Ukraine, I think that the basic problem is the same. No, you may work, you may act in a tactic way and try to please one or other layer of the society. And coalitional governments tend to do that. I see this in Slovenia. We have the pensionist party. You don't have it, I suppose. No? And they say, we are the guarantee that pensions will never go down in Slovenia. No? It will not also not go up, but they are anti-reform element in the government. And there is another party which is of the same nature. So in the situation as it is in Ukraine, the reforms are the only way. And the question is, I said continuity, but also dynamics. No, such things is better to do, I would say, as quick as possible. No, once you say we will do this in a very gradual way, then you lose the objective. And once things don't succeed, that the other government will not be very, very interested in I would say, doing that. The problem is who will do the so-called unpopular measures. No? And we cannot change the situation, especially if it is very, 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 very difficult, without unpopular measures. No? Then is the question of the leadership, whether they are able to communicate what they will do, how they will do, and who will get something of that. No? If we all have to pay, no, then the people have to be convinced that this is necessary. And I will mention one more, another friend of mine, Mr. Dombrovskis. He was sitting close to me in the European Parliament, former financial minister of Latvia. He became prime minister, and he said, tomorrow I will go down with my salary for 30%. Then my government, then administration, and so on. We will all go down in order to survive. You have two chances, to agree on 30%, or our youths will all go from this country somewhere else. Many went because the situation was bad already before, no? And he won with that two alternatives. He said, I will do that in just way. First, it's me who will pay, and so on. The problem appears when people see that some are benefiting more than the others, and that some don't share, and so on. So it's very important. I didn't speak about principle of justice, but in such situations, I would say the leadership must show very high ethical and moral standards. I wrote here again, unity and continuity. No. I was pleased today to see representatives of civil society who work together with those groups for reforms, with the government, and so on. I think is an excellent model. Here I see will not happen as this happened in Slovenia, where we were all part of civil society, and when we took over, the civil society disappeared because we all landed in the parliament and in the government, almost. But the same happened in Czech Republic. But this is just, I would say, by the way, remark. Foreign investments. This is, we would need a lot of time for that. In my country, a very known economist stated in the public that direct foreign investments do not improve economic situation at all. And there were many believers that many people said, oh yes, he has right, because you know, in the former communist countries, the concept of the enemy was very strong. No, I read a newspaper 35 years ago, no, not 27 years ago, and in that one newspaper I found 16 kinds of enemies of the state. liberals, neoliberals, clericals. I will not name all of them, no? And I see that this concept from time to time comes back, no? Then you have the concept of the Holy Land. Nobody will buy that and that, no? Nobody will take our good enterprises. Our problem in Slovenia now is that why we have to sell, and why we have to privatize the state-owned companies? Because we are that weak that we must do that. We will get 10 times less than 6 years ago, because there was the so-called national interest. We will never sell petrol, railway, port, and so on. There was a list of what we will never sell. Now we have to sell almost everything, because we are weak. And then one more, it's almost, I would say, fun to say that. When I spoke with American Slovenian Business Association and in Washington once, a businessman, American businessman, asked me, he said, Mr. Prime Minister, do you explain me this difference? He said, we wish to sell good companies in my country, but you wish to sell weak companies. He said, we get money if we have good companies, no? And then we invest in other companies. No? And this, you know, in Slovenia, this is not blackmailing of my country, but this is the situation is good to know. So we would like to sell weak companies for good money, no? But we wouldn't sell a good company for good money, no? And what it's obvious that the so-called national interests was only ideologic expression or political expression of those who wished to continue with monopolies or special privileges for them, because they were managers or I would say administrators of big companies, no? I would wish that now I will come back to sustainability, because you mentioned Ukraine. I wish that you develop such a business environment that foreign direct investments would love to come to Ukraine, that they will not fear conflict or too much administrative burdens, or too much legislation, and so on. No, and you know that this is not that easy. No, it's to get foreign direct investments. I think it's at the moment this is more or less political issue. No, we have to convince the others that it's worth to invest here. In Slovenia, we have very few direct investments now, very few, because Slovenia is not considered as a sustainable country because of lack of reforms. They know that we have to do that and that. They will come once we will, I would say, clean ourselves, let's say so. No? It's not very promising, but it's nobody else can do what you should do at home, let's say so. No, I'm not moralizing, and I don't like to be educational, but foreign direct investments are very, very, I would say, very, very vulnerable. Then I will finish very energy mix. I don't think that it changed a lot in Slovenia. I will add something from a conference in Brussels. Somebody asked, Greece has so much sun, no? But Germany has so much solar powers. No? Again, you know, if there is no political will, if there is no, I would say, a little bit stimulating money to use sun, no? Then it's not the guilt of Brussels that Greece has so few solar electricity, for example, no? No, you see that now I'm really becoming, trying to be a professor, but.
What is the actual energy mix? Like, how much of oil, gas,
We have almost one third is nuclear power plant, one third hydropower, and one third coal. I think it's something like that. I don't know exactly figures, but so any other questions?
We have time for a couple more questions.
I have time. My wife didn't ask me when to come back tomorrow to that.
Mr. Peterle, thanks for your speech. My name is Yaroslav Vasilyuk, and I want to ask one question. What do you think about EU in future, over 10 or 20 years, in generally? Thanks for answer.
I would wish that we would be able to get a new quality of the European Union without any new catastrophe. But in my short political career, I would say that Europe was progressing by catastrophes. New Europe was possible after fascism and Nazism were finished. Another step forward was possible once communism was finished. It's not finished everywhere, but we thought at that time. I think we will see new Europe, a little bit different Europe after this refugee crisis, no? Because it revealed so many of our weaknesses. We are not prepared for that, no? External border functioning in a proper way, Viktor Orban would not decide to do his wall around Hungary. But when he had already, I think, 38,000 of refugees who are coming into Hungary through green border and so on, then he decided to do something. And he's not the only one who does not know who are those who are coming, because they don't tell the names, they don't show documents and so on. We don't know who they are. We know, we in Slovenia, we registered one third of Syrians. There are people from Afghanistan, Eritrea, Kosovo, whatever. You see what is happening now in Germany. No? There is a very, 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 very hot debate what to do. And I was, when Angela Merkel was in our political group, he said, we will be very, very, very severe. Those who meet criteria to get asylum, they will get it. For the others, we will see whom we can accept and whom not. No? People from Kosovo, for example, I don't think that many will remain in Germany, because I think Kosovo is considered as a safe country. There is a terrible situation, social situation, economic situation. But also, you know, there is a question of capacity of a country. No, we can process almost 10,000 people who come to Slovenia. No. But once we go even over 8,000, we have problems. Fortunately, we have good cooperation with Austria, no? But we don't have that good cooperation with Croatia. And once we are not informed at all that the trains will come with new refugees, no? We are in troubles, no? And so let be faster in that answer. European Union will... has to agree on the main two, I would say, elements which were agreed by the founding fathers of the European Union. Respect for human dignity and do things together. No? We have to agree what we will do together. Cameroon will say, let's do less, let's get a little bit back, let's have single market, but not much more. No, I simplify a little bit, but in the end, I think that Cameroon will ask his voters to vote for European Union. This is my my expectation. No? And it's very difficult to predict now what will happen. No? If member states will not be able to overcome the asymmetry, I would say, in reforming will, then we will face problems. And again, I would say, we cannot have northern, I would say, understanding for rule of law and southern. And we don't, we may not have, we cannot survive with two fiscal cultures. No? And on the other side, we have to deal simultaneously with many crises at the same time. Greece, financial crisis was not overcome everywhere, refugee crisis, euro, and so on. Now, you see that in Switzerland, the right side won. In Austrian last elections, the right side also won. I can imagine that with some incidents in Germany, political landscape could change soon. No, I will not comment other situations. Madame Le Pen in France, I think that support for the popularity of her party is also growing. No, so we are facing a situation which was not known from the past. No, and I don't like that we go too deep to the past. No. Not at this border, not somewhere else. No, and we need leaders, but also citizens who will understand that we have to agree on how to live together. No, I think I will mention again. I don't like to see again border on Austria to stay there for 1 or 2 hours. Border with Germany, border with Belgium, no? To show passports, to show goods. To ask to change money and so on. So I think that we have to count also or to calculate also what does it mean less Europe, no? And what is the price for more Europe. No? In the European Parliament, which is the most legitimized, democratically legitimized institution, I think that we are quite close to the citizens who elected us, no? But we have three institutions. We have council, which may be quite different from us, no? And you saw that in the refugee crisis, no? So I'm not prophet to tell you what will happen, but I can for sure state that the less Europe, the more problems we will face.
My name is Olga. First of all, I would like to thank you for your lecture. It was very interesting and knowledgeable for me. So my question is connected with small and medium-sized businesses. I believe that they are the force which can push the economy forward and really improves economic situation in Ukraine. So the question is, what special conditions were created in Slovakia for the rapid development of this small and medium business? And maybe you can give a piece of advice how to create such conditions in Ukraine. Maybe they have to be connected with taxes or something else. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you for that question. It's very essential. I think that you have one element assured in that story, and this is entrepreneurial spirit of Ukrainians you may count on. Now, how politics can change framework conditions is again the question of the concept and of the political will. No? I mentioned before that in Slovenia, the first growth was there was a great share of small and medium business which was allowed, I would say, to use its unused potential. No? we had situation with one employed to one so-called small business, no? But if you double that to two, this is a huge development. Sometimes you need, I would say, not to change the law, but to have different understanding of that law or of under law, how is it called in English, podzakonski akt, regulations below the law, no, which minister can write, no, or state secretary, no. And I think that in Ukrainian case, or let begin in a different way, I studied in my previous business at Urban Planning Institute the most successful regions in the European Union, Bavaria, Lombardy, Flanders, and so on. And I came to the conclusion that the most propulsive and the best regions are those with high share of small and medium business. No, this does not mean you may not have big corporations or big business, but these are the most adaptable part of the economy, that they can switch fast from one on the other line and so on. And I think it's a strategic opportunity and strategic responsibility to free potential of the small business. No. And I know that you have a structure where, I would say, small business, which is also important for political and social stability, I would say it's at the moment it's quite low. But I think that the situation is changing. I would say the faster the better. No, sometimes we have laws which are unrealistic, or there are, for example, too strong conditions to open a shop. No? People don't have enough money, but they would like to start something, maybe in a garage or whatever. No, but then you can say, okay, in the 5 years you should have that and that. No, not tomorrow. No, sometimes we are too bureaucratic. No, and some things we may change with goodwill. Some things with laws, some things with governmental policy. I'm sure that it is possible to boost development of small and SMEs, let's say so. No? And I also see that there are political forces which wish that. I suppose that civil society is also in favor of that. And the concept or the recipe is known and it functions. No, there is no need to invent, as we say, hot water. No, just use policies which were successful somewhere else. But in my country, I remember, we had only one commune in former in the old Slovenian Republic, which was in a way allowed to have more small business. In the other communes, this was not so. No. But this is very rich commune, no? Because the private entrepreneur was considered as the Communist Party didn't like to have independent. No, they like to have big places with one loudspeaker. No, I was dealing with small industry in Slovenia, and I realized that despite the fact that we had this multi-center strategy, let's say so, polycentric development, this was called, no, but they didn't like to have too small enterprises, because then you cannot control them anymore. No. This was very simple at that time. I do hope that in your country this is not so, or it's not so anymore. No, I would say free the potential.
Next question.
If I might ask again, to couple the previous question about the small and medium enterprises, how would you comment the situation when, for example, Estonia right now offers the whole world an opportunity to make business through e-residence, and they try to become the Luxembourg of yet another Luxembourg of Europe, meaning that while we're waiting for the reform in Ukraine, you can register your business in Estonia, pay less taxes, go Europe, be eligible to the European funding. What shall keep us in Ukraine? Let's say, shall we somehow choose between being patriotic and wait for reform, or just, I don't know, mind our own wallets and go business?
Be patriotic with insisting for reforms. Yeah, I know people, even some friends of mine, I regret that to say, but the best, I mean, I can use the examples from my surroundings. No? If you are able to open a new enterprise in the neighboring country in one day or in 1 hour, no, why I would wait for 1 month, 2 or 3, no, how this was in the past, at home, no? It's you know, now we have to define what is national interests, no? To keep people here, despite the freedom of movement and so on. No? I don't like that we educate people and then they 8,000 in 1 year went to Germany and Austria, no? This is gift for each country where such people land. And I think that the best go, because those are more ambitious, no? And I would say, don't allow such an asymmetry. People go, people are very rational, and if Baltic countries will offer that opportunity, people will simply go there, and they will open a business from there once again in their country, no? But you can avoid that. No. I'm pleased if people go around, learn something and so on. And for Slovenians, for example, to go to Munich is 400 kilometers. It's not a distance, let's say so. No. But I would wish that they don't go there because the conditions are there better. No. I would wish that my country is the most attractive, first of all, for our people. it's here again that I would say speed is needed, good examples are needed, pilot projects are needed. And again, there are, you gave a very good example. One country who also invented Facebook, no? Skype, yeah, that's, you know, they had the idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I will give you one more example. We did a comparative study, which bank is the most expensive. The most expensive at that time was our main bank, no? Playing card of national interest. No? And I said, what is my interest to pay my bank only because it's Slovenian, I have to pay more, higher interest rates and so on. No? I remember Václav Klaus, you know, the former Czech finance minister. You know? He said, Alex, I don't have problems with that. We privatized all the banks and they function well. it's very difficult. It's very difficult, especially for former communist countries, you know, because there were, I would say, how it's called, closed economies, protected economies. Now we are living in another way. People go and come, money goes. No, I remember how much money left Russia after intervention in Georgia and so on. I was in Russia later and so on. The world is changing, and we simply cannot survive with all concepts, no. Again, the recipes are very simple, no. For example, one more, then I will finish with my answering for that question. In Slovenia, the idea of the communes was to prepare the so-called infrastructurally prepared ground for small businesses, no? But their idea was at the beginning, so to get as high price as possible, no? To tax the one who will land in the industrial zone or business zone somewhere, no? Now they are competing who will give the lower price to attract somebody, no? There are many possible stimulations, no? Because if you wish to get somebody, then you have also to give something, no?
Do we have more questions? Then I would like to ask one question. There was a question about Europe, and I would like to ask you about Ukraine. How do you see Ukraine in 10 or 20 years?
I don't like just to say depends on you. But I think that, in fact, depends very much on you or on those people I met today. You are the generation which will face the consequences of good or bad policy. And I don't like to be romantic with the concept of the so-called active citizenship we like to speak in Europe so much, no? And I don't think Kiev is the best place, the most appropriate place to tell an Indian story, but I will tell you. It's very instructive, no? Do you know Sri Sri Ravi Shankar? He's an Indian spiritual leader who is also a peacemaker in global terms and so on, and I attended in his ashram in Bangalore a huge meeting with young people, and somebody asked him, Sri Sri, why is so much corruption in my country? And he said, the problem is the following one. He said, we have so many good and honest people, but they don't say anything. The majority, I would say, are honest and good people. But my question is Ukrainian and Slovenian question is how to engage the entrepreneurial, moral, whatever potential of the people to do something, no? But this goes together with what government has to do. No, you rightly said, if you don't know what will be the tax for the next year? No, you will pay more or less or whatever, no? Business likes stable conditions. This is the prerequisite. I think that you are facing, in a way, different problems we are facing in Slovenia, but I'm sure that if you keep the spirit of change, good leadership, I don't like to repeat the coordination, unity, and so on, no, but there are some prerequisites how you can convince the people to participate and not to leave the country, how to do things which were done by somebody else already, how to implement them. I would say again, you have to work at all fronts simultaneously, no? And it's not necessary, this was also my case, that you will win elections because you were good in the government. Helmut Kohl united Germans to Germany's, and he lost elections. No? And he had good economy, but this was not the argument. No. I think that I will not speak about Ukrainian spirit. You know it better than me, but I see more spirit in your country. I would say more unity, more determination. What is needed, I think, is that you keep this process alive, that you don't stop, né? And that you agree, or that political forces in your country agree, what has to be done now and what tomorrow. No? And I think that the political leaders know what's the only program. No? I would wish that those who know and who act in that way, that they get support of the people. But I know that it's not that easy. I would also add that I think you never had so many friends that you have now. But I don't count only on Martin Centers and my 2 hours here. I think that Ukraine is on a new path, still facing many problems. But if you keep the spirit, the pace, then I think you will see in 10 years different Ukraine. I'm coming from time to time, so I can report on. I mean, I see the changes, but I would wish together with you that the changes occur in a more dynamic way. Or at least I would say don't allow to slow the process.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Спасибо большое.
Yeah, thank you all for coming today. And you can read more about our project on the website of Martin Center in the section Ukraine Reforms, and on the website of Kyiv School of Economics in the section Ukraine Reforms. Thank you.